Welcome to another video of Car Plebs. As you know, last year I got a Porsche 911 996 Carrera 2. I was looking for a fun, practical car, maybe a hot hatch like a Renault Megane RS or a fast wagon like a B5 S4. I found this 996. Alas, I ended up with it, and then I still told my spouse that it has 4 seats, so inevitably I retained my head. So let's get right into it. If you haven't yet subscribed, please do so, and also please hit like. Okay, so in terms of the design and quality, maybe it's subjective, but I have grown to love the exterior design of the 996, both the front headlights, the overall shape, and in my case, the fit in terms of my garage where I have a yellow 2S, which is not exactly subtle. To quote my wife, the black one is like a man in his 40s, while the yellow is like a teenager in a rock band. So in general, if I look at the 996 in terms of design, I think it fits very well into the segment. It's this crossover generation from the 993 to 997. I think it has some very unique traits, and I think that that's exactly why the values of the 996 will go up, because it's unique. It's the first water-cooled. It's the first one with the fried egg headlights. So in general, I really don't understand where all of the hate has come towards the 996 interior. Yes, it's not the most beautiful one, but in terms of design language, if you have curvaceous lines, then basically that implies that it will age quite well. You know, I can't fault it for anything. I mean, I'm looking at it and I just, yeah, I mean, it's an interior. It has very nice leathers. The seats are very well ergonomic. It has, you know, creature comforts like heated seats. I don't know, maybe the world is asking for like Witcher 3, you know. I'm not sure if everybody has seen that the new Tesla Model S has this huge center like landscape touchscreen thing, whatever, and that you can play Witcher 3 and things like that. Maybe that's what people want, but personally I don't care. When I'm driving, I don't need to have 5 displays here, and I don't know, like I just don't need it. So that's my thoughts on it. I want you to make up your own mind. So before you say, yeah, the 996's interior is terrible, please take it for a drive. In my case, I do have to say that I'm really happy that I got the 3-spoke steering wheel. It does improve the feel of the car much, because you have these thumb grips. The leather is in much better condition overall. It gives the car a more sporty feel. Then on top of that, I changed the radio. As you saw in the purchase overview, I only had this, I think it was a Blaupunkt, but like from the 2000s, so it didn't exactly fit the interior style. And because of that, I'm very happy that I have this CDR22 with the aux cable. So funnily enough, it's small things like this aux cable that really improve your day-to-day usability. So in general, touch points, I have to say fine. You know, the materials, they don't creak at all. So here, I have to say, I'm not sure it's visible on camera, but there is this like metallic finish to it. And in general, I don't see any signs of wear and tear, to be honest. Even after these 6 months, I've been driving it quite hard. Yeah, if I look at the leather handles, no wear and tear. Same with the handbrake, gear shift, steering wheel is obviously, well, not new, but this is a 20-year-old steering wheel that has never been upholstered. And if you just, again, it's a testament to the quality that was given to this car. So now in terms of reliability, I haven't had that many issues. I had some paint correction that needed to be done here. A little bit of rusting on the door lock mechanism, as I've mentioned. So now it's been completely fixed, which was pretty much somewhere over here. So body-wise, the car is in excellent shape. I have nothing basically here to add. In terms of engine, I mean, of course, that's going to be your biggest challenge with the 996. And of course, you have the topics like IMS. So a few things to discuss. One is the mechanical throttle body that you can see. So in terms of performance modifications, what I've done is I've installed the IPD plenum, which you can see on the top right hand corner. There will be a link. So then in terms of maintenance, I just basically had your regular costs. Your air oil separator needed to be changed. Then of course I changed the oil, I changed the engine coolant, etc. So like, you know, your basic service items, so to speak. And so from that perspective, I haven't had any issues whatsoever. I've driven a few thousand kilometers now. I have nil in terms of oil consumption. Oil pressure is fine. I regularly, and this is one heads up for everybody who has this car, which is very risky, is to check your oil fuel cap or your oil filler cap on a frequent as possible basis. And what you want to do is check whether there is any milking residue. That would be a sign that, for example, the head would be cracking. So that's something, or the cylinder liner specifically. So that's a common thing with the M96 engine, which is present on the 996 911. But other than that, if I have to be honest and I need to poke or knock on a stick or piece of wood, to be honest, nothing has happened here. So yeah, what I can say is that, you know, go ahead and buy one if a proper PPI needs to be done, and I can't stress this enough. I mean, you can't just buy one of these cars without one of those, or at least I wouldn't unless you're an experienced mechanic. But other than that, I mean, everything is dry, and of course that was another concern that I had, whether it's going to be seeping from the RMS / IMS region, and nothing. Yeah, and I have to say, even the IMS issue, I've spoken now to many mechanics, it's severely overblown for what it is. So realistically, there's going to be a low likelihood that your car per se will have that. I mean, if it's above 100,000 kilometers, and you have to take your risk selection here. I mean, you have to decide from a risk perspective if you are bearing the risk and if you're fine with that or not. But yeah, I mean, I was hoping that I would be able to provide for this video like much more information in terms of what I have done in order to maintain, repair the engine, etc. Perfectly fine. As opposed to my 997, which is right now being inspected for an RMS / IMS leak, which I will have a video coming up soon. In terms of the mods, just a quick summary. So as mentioned, IPD plenum, absolutely recommend, increases the intake sound. I honestly don't know whether it increases horsepower, but I mean, I'm completely fine with that. Then I do have the BMC sports air filter, as well as I capped off here the Helmholtz resonator, which you can see on the video above. But other than that, I kept it pretty much stock, except for, like, you know, small things that I've done overall to the car, which is, you know, just making sure it looks nice. These new center Porsche crests, because it had these silver ones, which look terrible. And then, amidst your day-to-day drive, you can just do that all the time. One thing I would want to mention here is that I prefer driving this as opposed to my E92 M3 with DCT. The connection here is just far better. You feel connected to all of the inputs. It's just a completely different car. Whereas in the Mustang or in the E92, you feel the V8 lumbering in front of the engine, or in the front of the car. So as you change direction, you feel rather a delay in terms of how that translates to the road. And here it's just instantaneous. And so we're soon on my warm-up drive route. So let's take it for a spin. Tires, because they had zero grip, and with the Michelin cross climates, it does ruin the emotional side just a bit. Oh, progression, throttle response, intake noise, I mean, come on. And just the balance of the car. Again, after 6 months, I can just constitute the fact that, you know, the E92 is a great platform for starters in a way that, you know, it has a lot of potential, but the E92 M3, I just can't recommend it. And this is the thing with a Porsche. They know you're gonna drive it like this, and therefore the temperature doesn't increase. So in my M3, it would consistently rise very quickly, the temp gauge. And here, like, you know, I mean obviously I'm not driving 10-10 out of, on a track. I'm on a public road, so obviously I'm going to take it more easy. But still, this is another big factor that I've noticed, which is basically the temper or heat management of this car. Yeah, so that about sums up the driving section. So again, thank you very much for watching another video of Car Plebs. I just couldn't resist. very much appreciate that I have the whistle, because that tells me that I'm going approximately 18 kilometers per hour, so I'm very happy for that. Otherwise, I wouldn't know that it's time to slow down.